Headline Audio presents The Shetland Sea Murders by Marsali Taylor, read by Angela Ness. Part 1. A Ring Around the Moon. Chapter 1. Saturday the 19th of October. Tide times at 8th. HW 0:00 hours 32, 2.0 meters. LW 6:35, 0.9 meters. HW 12:50, 2.0 meters. LW 19:05, 0.9 meters. Sunrise 7:53. Moonset 14:24. Sunset 17:44. Moonrise 1948. Waning gibbous moon. The Mayday startled me awake in the middle of the night, crackling through the speaker of the handheld radio in Swan's aft cabin. I heard Magni stir in the berth below me and reach out a hand to grab it and turn the volume up.
Day, Mayday!
It was a man's voice, heavily accented, and sounding as if he was reading from a script.
Shetland Coastguard, this is fishing vessel Dorabella, Dorabella, Dorabella. With 13 people aboard, we on rocks the west side V Skerries, beside Papa Stewart. We request immediate assistance. Shetland Coastguard, Mayday, Mayday, Mayday.
I wriggled forward in my bunk and snicked my light on. We were all awake now, Magni with the hand held black by his ear, and Geordie, the engineer, leaning out of his berth, all listening intently as a calm voice from Shetland Coast Guard requested further details. It was a struggle to get the information. Dorabella was a 30-metre-long liner registered in the Ivory Coast, but with the owners in France. Nope, nobody was hurt. The ship wasn't in immediate danger. There was no water coming in, no apparent damage to the engines. They were still running to keep the fish fresh. They'd been on their way to port with a full hold. Yes, they'd tried to reverse off, but with no success. And the tide had come as high as it was going to. They were stuck fast. Magni came out of his berth, pulling his jeans and a jumper on over his sleeping thermals, and I wriggled out of mine and followed suit. We went up into the stillness of the night. We were anchored off Femintry Isle on the west side, round the corner from Bray, and just opposite where I'd grown up. The wooden deck below our feet belonged to Swan, Shetland's own tall ship, a converted Fifey fishing boat which had been built here over a century ago. My friend and former sailing teacher Magni was in charge and enjoying skippering a proper fishing boat again. He could just remember Swan as a working boat. He'd been a boy when she'd left Shetland in the 50s, when she'd been rediscovered, half sunk and rotting in an English harbour. He'd been one of the campaigners to bring her hull back and restore her as a living memorial of the Shetland fleet in the great herring days. Given his fishing experience and his skipper's ticket, he was now a valuable volunteer crew. It was a weekend trip, a charter for a shearer man who was celebrating his 60th, and later than Swan would normally do, because by mid-October, the weather was too uncertain. It could be a golden autumn weekend or a flying gale from the north, chilling as winter. But this was when Shearer's birthday was, and he had a sudden fancy to take his sister and nieces on a three-island trip to see the guns of Femintry, the caves of Papa Stour, on the western corner of the Shetland mainland, and the cliffs of Fowla, 17 miles out into the Atlantic. It just so happened that Papa Stour was also hosting a music weekend, with a concert on the Saturday evening, so we were going to that while we were there. He was a friend of the trustees, He'd wangled the Swan a good insurance deal with his firm, which took some doing with a 100-year-old wooden boat, whose remit included paying passengers and school trips. And Swan needed all the cash she could get, so the secretary had taken the booking and crossed fingers for decent weather.
"Besides," Geordie the engineer had said cheerfully, "it gets me out of all the work at home on Papa with this music evening we're going to. Every house on the island is full as it can get, and baking and boiling all day on every cooker. I'm well clear of it."
There were four passengers: Stevie Shearer, his sister, and her two daughters. Stevie had been the first to arrive, roaring up on what even I could see was a classic bike. Scarlet, with those leaning back handlebars, and the chrome of the engine polished silver bright. He'd come over and greeted us all cheerily, then gone back and spent 10 minutes padlocking the wheels and draping a tarpaulin over it. There was a touch of cliché about him, the jet black hair sleeked back, the sleeveless T-shirt, Harley Davidson tattoos on both arms, hidden, I presumed, by his shirt when he was brokering insurance, tight jeans and round-toe biker boots. He was one of those jovial characters who was too touchy-feely for me, a bit too matey in the way he'd steadied himself on the perfectly steady gangplank by putting one arm around me. He'd apologised, of course, and added a joke. "Why is a sailor like an uncaught criminal?" I'd remembered I was paid crew and smiled nicely. "I don't know, why is a sailor like an uncaught criminal?"
"They both need plenty of rope."
He laughed uproariously. I did a token gesture smile and invited him to make himself at home on deck. The women were not long behind him, his sister and one daughter together, and the other in a separate car. Stevie's sister was older, maybe 10 years older, going by the age of the daughters, who looked to be in their late 40s, and chalk and cheese. One dressed with the neat colour coordination of a worker in the public eye, the other in a swirling patchwork skirt and cheesecloth blouse. Their mother had the look of an ageing hippie too, but it was the conventional daughter she'd come with, and I felt a bit of tension in the way she and the colourful daughter greeted each other, quickly smoothed over by Stevie's exuberant welcome to them both. I hoped it wasn't going to be one of those occasions where an attempt to patch up a quarrel by forcing people together just made everything worse. We got them all on board, gave the safety briefing, then left the Waw's pier. It was 5 o'clock now, and Steeket mist, with the marker buoys and lines of mussels appearing suddenly from the greyness around us. The shore colours were dulled by it: ochre seaweed, charcoal rocks, olive hills with their tops hazed by cloud. The sea stacks off the back of Vela loomed through the mist and were swallowed again. Our passengers made themselves comfortable on deck and watched the world go by. Stevie and his sister, with their backs propped against the dinghy, the two sisters one on each side of the hatch. Stevie kept coming out with awful jokes, and there was protesting laughter from the others. Once we were out into the Atlantic, the mist thinned. There wasn't enough wind to get the sails up, but the late afternoon sun was warm on our backs as we came through Papa Sound, the strip of water separating Papa Stour from the mainland. We crossed the south end of St. Magnus Bay into the Rona Channel and anchored in the bay to the back of the World War I guns on Vementry Isle. The clear sky gave us a long twilight, with daylight on deck until well after 7. Our passengers sat around on deck, chatting under a half moon, the colour of newly polished brass, while I put a pot of tatties on and Geordie cast for mackerel, using a wand with a dozen hooks. He struck lucky straight away.
They came up twisting and flashing silver bellies below their tiger-striped green and black backs. He caught each with a hand and tweaked it free, a twist of the fingers to break the gills. Then he dropped them into the bucket, still flapping. We'd eaten our supper of fried mackerel and tatties around the wooden table in the main cabin that had once been the ship's fishhold. And I'd thought, with a twinge of nostalgia, that this was right home food. There was nothing like fresh caught mackerel, the sweet flesh and the oiliness of it sopped up by the oatmeal. Magni had done an apple crumble and custard, and after that there'd been birthday cake and champagne under glittery happy birthday banners. Then we'd sat on deck watching the stars come out until the good sea air had sent our family yawning to bed. Now, the water was shifting silver in the moonlight, with the long Atlantic swell rolling over it, the hills outlined dark against the midnight sky. The wind had fallen away completely, and there was the cold tang of frost in the air. There was a ring around the three-quarters moon, sign of a warm front approaching, with the changeable weather that would bring. Magni and I stood in silence on the deck, looking at the dark headland of Vementry Isle between us and the open sea, and thinking of the boat on the rocks, 12 miles beyond it. The V Skerries was a horrible spot, a treachery of wicked rocks stretching out from the Ormel, the largest of them. I'd often seen the grey smudge of the white concrete tower built there far on the horizon. You couldn't see the rocks themselves, for they lay too low. If we'd been out in the Rona, we'd just have been able to make out its light, flashing white twice every 20 seconds. The men of the Aberdeen trawler, Ben Doran, had died there in the 1930s. In the 70s, the last of the men of the Eleanor Viking had been lifted off the same spot only 10 minutes before their boat had begun breaking up. I stood there in the darkness and prayed with all my might for these men there now. Geordie came up to join us. Any news? A clatter of the radio answered him, the Coast Guard moving Dorabella to a working channel. We changed too, and listened as the Coast Guard helicopter was scrambled and the lifeboat. 10 minutes later, we heard the lifeboat's engines as she set out from her pier down at Aith. It took her no time at all to reach us, a whitewash streaming from her bows as she passed through the Rona at full speed. The roar beating out through the calm night, then diminishing into the distance. Swan rocked to her passing, and the waves crashed white on the beach 30 metres from us. 12 miles, and the lifeboat's top speed was 25 knots. She'd be there in half an hour. The fishing boat's radio operator had said they were in no danger at the moment and there was nothing to harm them in the weather. The lifeboat would get them off safe from that wilderness of rocks as long as it could manoeuvre up to them. The Ben Doran had been unlucky. She'd steamed right in between the rocks in the days before lighthouse and lifeboat and ended up stuck in the middle of them. She'd had no radio on board. By the time another boat had spotted her, the wind had risen, and the sea was a boiling turmoil around them. A number of other trawlers had braved the conditions to go out there. They'd seen 7 men tied to the rigging in their oilskins, but been unable to get to them. "How came they?" Magni said. "To go up all the V Skerries on so calm a night. 30 metres long, they said. You're no telling me a boat that size didn't have the latest sort of chart plotter to tell them within an inch where they were." "A chart plotter still needs someone to look at it," I said. "It was the lights, wasn't it, with the Ben Doran? They were gutting fish, and the glare of the gas lights blinded them. Maybe these men were busy hauling in their lines and not looking around them." "You can get good fishing around the Skerries," Geordie said. He was from Papastour and knew the area. "They've maybe been over keen to get a good catch and drifted closer than they should have. and then not been able to get their lines up in time to avoid the rocks? But didn't they say they were heading for port with a full hold? I asked.
That wouldn't stop them wanting to take in a few more, Geordie said.
Magni nodded.
13 men, that's short-handed on a 100-footer. I'd have expected 15. The owner's cutting costs, Geordie said cynically. Cheap foreign seamen paid starvation wages and no attention to health and safety once they'd got their certificate.
The Ben Doran had had a crew of 9. The bodies of the last 2 had been found later, washed up with a great coil of rope between them. They'd been the strongest swimmers of the crew, and it was thought they'd tried to swim the rope to the Ormel to get the others across to the rock above the water. Their graves were in Sandness Kirk. Greater love hath no man than that he laid down his life for his friends. I shook the sorrow away. The chopper had airlifted the men of the 70s Eleanor Viking off. The modern Oscar Charlie was on its way. Even if the lifeboat couldn't get to them, these men would be saved. I glanced at the time on the plotter behind us and became practical. 12:30. Neat tides too, I said. Unless they're lucky and get a big swell at the next high tide, the boat will be stuck there until the new moon. 10 days.
If she lasts that long, 10 days without a gale in the second half of October.
I made a face. No boat would last long with an Atlantic gale washing over her.
The forecast's good for the weekend, Geordie said. They'll maybe find some way of getting the fish off if they can keep the generator running for the refrigeration. Shame to waste it,
Magni agreed. There was a distant thrumming in the air, like a far-off bumblebee. It grew closer and filled the air, the chopper on its way over. We waited and listened until the last noise of it had died away, and the night was silent again. The stillness was broken by a ringing phone from the main cabin. It broke off. There was a muttered voice, and then there were steps on the companionway. Stevie Shearer came out, in a t-shirt and shorts, phone to his ear, and went straight to the bow without looking back at us. It was like him, I thought, to assume he was alone on deck, just because he wanted to be. His voice floated clearly aft, in workmanlike French.
What do you mean on the rocks?
There was silence again as he listened.
Okay, but the engine's still running. Can you get the fish from the hold?
Another silence. Then he said,
I'll see what I can do. Don't make any stupid admissions. You were steaming back to port with a full hold. Get them in then. Cut them if need be.
He jerked the phone from his ear and stood for a moment, looking out. We'd stayed by the wheel, aft, turning our shoulders to his conversation. Now, out of the corner of my eye, I caught a flash of something white moving in the black square of the main cabin entrance. I turned my head to look properly and glimpsed a face, someone hovering at the top of the ladder. She saw my movement and ducked back, but I could still see the white shoulder of a t-shirt at the side of the doorway. She was still there, listening. Stevie punched in a number with angry jabs of his fingers and put it to his ear again. He spoke in English this time.
The Dorabella's on the V Skerries. Yes, stuck fast. The men are to be airlifted off. They've kept the refrigeration unit running, but we need to empty that hold. Yes, get onto it right away and organise someone to meet the men. We'll speak tomorrow.
He rang off and turned to come back towards the companionway. The white shoulder vanished, but I thought I caught the soft thud of feet going hastily downwards, one metallic rattle of a bunk curtain being drawn. Now at last, Stevie saw us standing there at the wheel and did a double take, then came to join us.
Hope I didn't wake you.
Magni shook his head.
The Mayday did that.
He left it at that, but Stevie rushed into speech.
She's one of ours, my firm insured her.
If they can't get her off soon, she'll be a total loss. But with no loss of life, I said.
Yeah, yeah,
he agreed quickly. That's the important thing, of course. And if it's possible to get the fish off her, that should help.
She may be lucky and float off tomorrow, Geordie said.
Let's hope so,
he shrugged, turned his head quickly as if he'd heard a noise in the main cabin, stared for a moment, then looked at us.
Well, I'll get back to my bed.
He gave a cursory glance round, up at the star-filled sky, with the sickle of the charioteer hanging above the ward of Muckle Row.
A bonny night. See you in the morning.
He sketched a wave and headed back below.
Well,
Magni said. He looked around at the silvery water, the dark hills, and gave his shoulders a shake.
We'll have these folk to give a good time tomorrow. Shall we turn back in?
Leave the radio on, I said.
Yeah, yeah, I'll do that.
We went below, still listening as the Coast Guard directed operations. The helicopter arrived at the skerries, just as we were back in our bunks, and began lifting the men off straight away. They could take all 13. The men would be landed at the Clickerman in Lerwick, would be checked out in the hospital, then handed over to Aubrey and his volunteers of the Fisherman's Mission. It must have felt an age to those men, standing on their deck in the flashes of the lighthouse. But to us, on board Swan, it seemed an incredibly short time before the chopper was reporting that they had all men safe and they were heading for Clickerman. The lifeboat coxswain reported that they were standing down. Soon after, we heard the chopper drone above our heads again, with those men safely aboard, and then the lifeboat heading homewards. Swan rocked to her wash. Magni switched back to channel 16 and turned the volume down.
Well, folk, I'm going back to sleep.
He turned over, and soon his snores were vibrating against the wooden walls. Geordie's joined them. I lay awake for a bit longer. My berth was stuffy compared to my own Kalida, the 8-metre yacht that was my home, where the hatch was right by my head. And I missed my cat and kitten, who'd been left with Dad and Maman for this weekend. Cat felt at home with Maman's brand of elegance, which included a glowing peat fire and a comfortable Chinese rug, to say nothing of exotic scraps from the kitchen. And Dad had installed a cat flap in the back door so that he could come and go, as he was used to. I was less sure about Kitten, who'd never lived in a house before, but given the way she installed herself on the captain's red velvet couch at every opportunity, I suspected she'd make herself at home on Dad's Chesterfield. She looked frail and delicate, but there was an iron paw inside every one of those little white mittens. I wasn't going to get back to sleep anytime soon. I turned onto my back, crossed my hands behind my head, and contemplated my world. I'd done my first 6 weeks of life aboard Sorlana as an A-plus academy. Sorlana was the smallest of the three Norwegian tall ships, a three-masted square-rigged beauty. Like all tall ships, she'd been funded by a mixture of grants and paying passengers. But at last, she'd found financial security as a floating college for older teenagers. They'd learn regular lessons, seamanship and life skills as they helped sail her around the world, stopping at ports where they could have time off and their parents could fly over and join them. Her crew was supplemented by qualified teachers, and we had 60 trainees on board, 16 and 17-year-olds, 30 boys, 30 girls. They were divided into watches of 10, two-hour watches, and they were young and silly and needed to play music all the time, which drove me round the bend. I checked myself. I was being unfair. Some, of course, were already keen sailors and fitted straight into the life of the ship, a pleasure to be with. Others, well, for example,
the one who'd been given the choice of military college or Sorlana, he was going to be trouble. Already, he was moving from dumb insubordination to active malice. In his hands, plates slipped and ropes tangled, or were knotted in a way that meant you couldn't release them as fast as you might need to sometimes. Nothing major, so far, but a tall ship at sea wasn't the place for pranks. And the girl, who'd been affronted that second day on board, to find that nobody had ironed her sheets during the day. Well, she was learning, and the experience of being the other half would do her good. I had an ulterior motive for being on board the Swan. Her captain of the last 10 years had just retired, which was why Magni was officer in charge, and I'd been hauled in to help. The captain's post would be advertised in spring. Now was my chance to get to know more about her, in case I decided to apply. I had the paper qualifications and the experience in sail training ships, but I knew less than I needed to about old-fashioned fishing boat rigs like Swans, and nothing about how she functioned otherwise. Generators, engines, safety procedures. The post would probably go to her current mate, the one I was standing in for, currently with her leg in plaster after too enthusiastic a tackle in a hockey game. But in that case, there would be a mate post free. The thing was, Sorlana's academy routine was 6 weeks on, 6 weeks off while she was in European waters, and 8 weeks elsewhere. I'd had a good think about Cat and Kitten and decided that it would be best for them to come home and live with my partner Gavin full-time. Otherwise, it would be a nightmare of passports and vet visits and flights. I'd miss them, of course, but it wouldn't be for long each time. I wanted Gavin and me to work. He was a Police Scotland DI, and we'd met through his first case up here, the Longship murder, 1.5 years ago. I paused to wonder at that. It felt now like I'd always known him. We'd managed a long-distance relationship so far, but then Gavin had requested transfer out of the National Serious Crime Squad and back to a local post. When his boss had offered a Shetland post at the same seniority level, we'd talked about living together. He'd made it clear that he wanted me to be part of that. Otherwise, he'd hold out for an Inverness posting near his own home hills. I'd thought hard about it. I knew there'd be the usual adjustments. But the biggest for me was that it might mean me having to give up sailing oceans. We both wanted children. And for that, I'd have to stay ashore, where Gavin's job was. If I got a berth on board Swan, it wouldn't be full-time, as my Sorlana post was, so I'd have to save harder during the months I was at sea to keep paying my share of household expenses over the winter. And I'd probably need to pick up shore jobs as well, but we'd be together more. Swan would be busy all summer, including longer trips, but as her base was Shetland, I'd be able to get home in between them. And early and late summer were generally haimabut trips, day sails with schools or charter guests, or weekends sailing round Shetland. I'd be completely away only from June to mid-August, instead of the current 6 or 8 weeks on, then the same off. I'd been asking around on Sorlana about how couples were finding that rota and getting mixed responses. My watch leader, Peter, reckoned it worked well, easier than being separated from Friedrich for the whole summer. Another officer, Jonas, said his wife hated it. She just got used to getting along without me when I arrive and throw things out, and then we're just getting into a routine when I go again. Well, I'd just have to see how Gavin and I got on with it. He was used to living on his own all week at his Inverness flat, though he went home to the family farm for weekends. His brother Kenny would miss his help, especially as their mother was getting less able. Not that she'd admit to it. If I was home all winter, if a job came up for him in Inverness,
we could open up his cottage further along the loch and commute between the flat and his loch together. Or I could stay at the loch and help about the farm while he worked in town. I knew that he'd want to go home eventually. He'd be based in Shetland for now, but his hills would call him, just as the sea called me. Meantime, once this trip was over, I needed to get on with getting our rented cottage ready for Gavin moving up here in 3 weeks' time. It was going to be strange living together on land. I yawned and went to sleep. Chapter 2. There was only the faintest of ripples along Swan's green hull when I woke. I turned onto my side and squinted at my watch. 5:50. Magni was still snoring, and Geordie joined in with the occasional snort. The air was sour, in spite of the open hatch at the top of the ladder. I pulled my jeans and jumper over my pyjamas and climbed quietly up, socks and shoes in hand. Yes, it was very still. Up here on deck, the first clear light was a milky streak above Weatherstaw. As I watched, it spread along and began to brighten over Linga, to the south of east, where the sun would rise. A seal came up 5 metres from the side of the boat, turning his dog profile from side to side to get a good look at me and sculling with spotted flippers. The generator cleared its throat and rumbled into life, breaking the silence. Magni must be up, and our trainees soon would be. I headed down into the darkened main cabin and crossed it to the galley. A cup of tea all round would go down well. I kept my face turned away from the cabin, as sighs and curtain noises signalled people getting up. Stevie's sister was the first, trailing past me to the heads in a glory of patchwork dressing gown. It took me a moment to remember her name. Amatola, that was it. She gave me a friendly smile as she passed. She had long curly hair, dark but streaked with grey, which made her brother's gleamingly black head even more implausible. It was held back from her face by a headscarf, tied like a hairband. She had that weathered complexion of someone who spent a lot of time outdoors, her brother's prominent beaked nose and startlingly white brows above her dark eyes. I tried to remember Magni's character summary.
One of those causes, folk you ken, woman's causes. She was one of the ones making a fuss for equal pay at the council. And she volunteers for the women's aid folk, that kind of thing. She's a regular at the alting debates. Believes a better world can be made by working for it.
If we all really worked at it, maybe it could, I'd said. Particularly if the men worked at it too.
Yeah, maybe.
He gave me a sideways look out of his pebble green eyes.
You're young yet. She's retired now, but she had a peary cafe in Sandwick for a while. Home-baked bannocks, fancies, and everything made with goat milk for folk who hae allergies.
His tone was vaguely approving, so I gathered her baking past muster.
She does this wild swimming, too, you ken, going off in the sea in wetsuits to commune with seals and the like.
She's never thought of standing for the council if she wants to improve things. Magni snorted.
As if that would do any good. You'd need more women than 4 or 5 to make any impression on that lot. She bides in a peary who's just out of Sandwick. Well, it used to be out of town before they built all those new houses around her.
I made a face at that and sympathised with Amatola, who moved to the country and found the town catching up with her. I hoped she'd enjoy the weekend away from it.
Aye, aye,
Amatola said on her way back. I heard the creak as she clambered back into her berth, then more creaks as she got dressed inside it. Within 5 minutes, she was back, just as bright, in a rainbow-striped knitted waistcoat, over a loose white top and red cord trousers. She sat down on the edge of the bench seat to do up her DMs, then came into the galley. She might have been 70, but her movements were brisk and sure.
What can I do to help?
Thanks. Can you set mugs out for everyone? Magni was talking pancakes for breakfast, but a cup of tea first thing always goes down well.
Mugs.
She did a quick head count. 4 of us and 3 crew. Right. She began taking the swan china mugs from the holder above the sink, a brisk, accustomed movement. Today we're going to Papastour, aren't we?
We'll go ashore on Vermintry first and have a look at the guns, then head on for the Papa Caves, and finally into House of O for the night.
I lived on Papa, for nearly 5 years back in the 70s. Her face was wistful. I loved being there. It was so quiet. You'd pause while you were working and just stand for a moment and listen to the silence. And there was the smell of the flowers and the stars in the winter nights. So bright, I used to tell the girls they were made of diamonds from the sky goddess's broken necklace. A shadow came over her face. For a moment, her eyes were dark, with what looked like anger.
Well, that was then. I hope it's not a mistake going back.
She shook off the bleakness and spoke cheerfully. But Stevie was so keen on this trip that he got me persuaded. I've never seen the guns either, nor landed on Fowler.
She set the last mug down, reached into the fridge for a carton of milk, and moved into the cabin, shaking the curtain of the bunk above hers.
Moon, cup of tea for you?
She turned to the next bunk.
Sky?
There was a muffled protest from within the bunk.
Sorry, Kirsten, cup of tea?
She turned back to me. I'll just go up on deck, give other people room to get dressed. I watched the red trousers and green boots climb upwards, back in the 70s. Papa had had a colony of hippies living there then, and I'd have taken no bets on whether Amatola had been one of them. That explained her daughter's names, Moon and, apparently, Sky. Moon was the colourful one, her sister, every inch the sober council employee, in trousers coordinated with her jumper, sensible shoes, and a contrasting scarf at her neck, had introduced herself firmly as Kirsten. I didn't blame her. I'd shortened my French Cassandra. Maman had been singing in the Trojan Women while she was pregnant with me, to Cass, on my first day in primary one. I poured 3 mugs, added the milk and sugar of preference for Magni and Geordie, and headed upwards into the air. Amatola was sitting on the foredeck hatch, singing softly to the seal in a bonny alto voice. Magni was up and leaning over the wheel, pebble green eyes surveying the last wisps of mist on the Bray Hills. I passed him his mug.
Thanks to you, lass.
He jutted his chin downwards.
Are they rising?
I'm leaving them to it. Amatola woke her daughters. I set the tray down and called below.
Geordie, cup of tea for you. The smell of breakfast will soon get them to their feet.
Nothing like sea air, I agreed. I was beginning to feel peckish myself. Breakfast on board Sorlana was at 7:30, and it must be getting on for that now.
I'll go and start these pancakes, Magni said.
He drained the last of his tea and headed below. I nipped down and dressed properly, washed my face, managed to coax a comb through my hair and replaited it. Then came back on deck and watched as the grey bands of cloud at last flushed pink from below, and then the sun shone silver between them, even further to the southeast than I'd been looking, almost over the cottage we'd rented, too bright to look at. A good omen for Gavin and I. I was just reflecting that I was being ridiculously nervous, looking for good luck in the position of the rising sun, when Stevie came up on deck, stretching. The smell of pancakes drifted after him.
Good morning, good morning,
He sang cheerfully. Here's a morning joke for you, Cass. What's the best thing about Switzerland?
The mountains? I guessed.
Don't know about them, but the flag is a big plus.
I groaned, obligingly, and headed below to help. Everyone was up now. Kirsten's short hair was neat above moss-green jumper and jeans. Moon's long hair was in wild curls around her shoulders. You'd not have taken them for sisters from a distance, but close up, there was no missing the resemblance, the family bony nose and their mother's dark eyes. Moon's skin was weathered to a brown tan. Kirsten's was soft and pink, as if she lived an indoor life. The biggest difference in their faces was the expression. Kirsten was office worker brisk and competent. Moon, dreamy, as if she barely saw the world around her. I put maple syrup and bananas on the table, then squeezed past Magni and began doling out cutlery, followed by the platefuls of pancakes, passed to the nearest person, then handed round the square table with the sun in traditional fashion. By the time everyone else was served, my stomach was rumbling. I joined the others at the table, squished a banana over my pancake and helped myself to maple syrup.
Any more news of the Dorabella this morning?
Stevie asked. I shook my head. Nothing on the radio.
We should try SIBC, Magni said.
He gave the ship's clock a glance.
Nearly 8:30. Snick on the radio, would you, Geordie?
Geordie rose.
It's the weekend,
he objected, as he reached up to the dials above the chart.
I doubt they won't have updated their news broadcast yet.
Nor had they. We got a local teacher winning a national physics award, the fencing team doing well in Birmingham, and a lost dog, but no mention of the trawler. Geordie switched it off again, and Stevie explained to everyone else.
But they got all the men off safe, Magni said, and that's the main thing. You never know. If they can lighten the hold, she may just float off good as gold.
He rose.
Who's for more pancakes before we go and explore the guns?
We ferried them ashore in Swan's inflatable, leaving Geordie aboard as anchor watch. There was still a scar on the hill above us, where the heavy barrels had been winched up from the naval ship that brought them 100 years ago. It had been a feudal world then, I reflected, with crofters still dominated by the laird, and women in long skirts and cartwheel hats asking for votes for women. It was a bonny walk upwards on the soft turf, with the last yellow hawkweed still bright against the green grass. We came at last up onto the plateau of the hill and stood looking around. I only knew the Vementry guns from sailing below them. From the Rona, the hill they sat on looked as if a giant had taken a bite out of the top of it, and you could just make out the gun mountings and the long barrels pointing seawards. They'd been put there in World War I to defend the fleet, which had lurked in St. Magnus Bay and come into Swarback's Min, the hand-shaped piece of water between Aeth, Vaux and Bray, to anchor and refuel. There had been a coaling station at Weatherstaw, and the admirals of the fleet had stayed at Booster House. They'd gone from here to the Battle of Jutland. The guns were impressively large this close. There were three of them, the two covering St. Magnus Bay, mounted on a wide concrete platform with a little parapet around it, and the third, on its own, barrel pointing over the Rona. The firing ends on the platform were well over my height, their cogs and levers red with rust, and the projecting barrels were a good 4 metres long. They could fire shells a distance of 12 miles, Magni told our passengers, and fire accurately at 6 miles. A step on each side of the workings showed where the men had stood, eyes narrowed against the bright light coming through the lookout slit. Below the platform were grassed-over foundations where their accommodation hut had been. I had a vague notion the actual hut had been transferred to Aeth, to become part of the old school buildings. Our guests scattered out around them. Stevie climbed up on top of one of the gun mountings and stood there, turning slowly round. Jokes temporarily and mercifully stopped, face alight with interest. Amatola and Moon clambered onto the barrel and balanced on it. Kirsten watched them from a distance, then shrugged and complied as they called her over to take photos. If you hadn't been photographed doing it, you hadn't been there. She leaned against the gun below them while I took several photos of all four of them with their camera. Amatola and Moon gathered round her to look at my efforts, laughing. When Stevie wandered over too, all ready with another joke, I headed swiftly to the lookout post by the third gun. It was a basic concrete turret, with a wide slit at head height and no protection against the elements. Just past it were dark lines in the grass where the soldiers had cast their peats. I scanned the pale blue water, the near-red cliffs of Muckle Row, and the far-off grey of Eshinus through the slit, then came out and walked over to the third gun. It couldn't have been a fun posting, I reflected, sitting down on the soft turf with my back wedged against the parapet, and the sea spread dazzling below me, out here for weeks, in all weathers. But then, the alternative was the trenches. By comparison, this was a cushy number. That led me on to wondering how they'd felt when they'd gone home. They'd have heard about the scale of the slaughter, of course. They would have, in newspapers and letters from their mothers, sisters, sweethearts. I wondered if they'd really believed it until that last boat had come to take them off, kit bags over their shoulders, and they'd returned to their villages to find most of their contemporaries gone, and those that were left walking like old men on staffs, maimed almost beyond recognition, or crippled by gas. Had they felt guiltily grateful for the windswept island that they'd cursed as a hellhole for those 4 years? I was about to stand up when there were voices behind me, softly, confidential, as if the speakers had come over here to be alone. "Have you thought any more about what I was telling you about?" It was Moon's voice. There was something childish about the way she spoke. Her voice was high in pitch and level in tone. They were standing on the gun parapet right above me. If they'd looked down, they'd have seen me. I was just easing my legs forward to stand up when one calf locked into cramp. I gritted my teeth and leaned back, stretching the muscle out. Above my head, Kirsten replied, her voice soft but sharp with exasperation. "You're going to ruin this weekend if you start going on about it." "Now you're pretending you've forgotten again." Kirsten's voice hardened. "There's nothing to forget. I'm older than you, remember?" She paused as if she was looking round to make sure nobody was listening. Her voice went from anger to coaxing. "Uncle Stevie was a cool uncle. Remember all the fun we had with him? Going swimming from the sands of sound and having water fights, and that time we went camping and made a real fire." "You didn't like camping," Moon said. "You said there were creepy crawlies, but you liked it." She sounded like she was trying to reason with a 4-year-old. "You loved it, and remember the time he brought you that talking doll for your birthday?" "But maybe he was grooming us. Oh, for goodness sake." Kirsten abandoned persuasion and went into big sister mode. "Moon, will you just get it into your head that just because some half-baked therapy has you remembering God knows what, doesn't mean it actually happened? Induced memories, they call it. Their questions suggest what they want to hear, and your hypnotized state makes you want to be helpful, so you give them what they want. Haven't you heard about people being persuaded they've been abducted by aliens or reincarnated from being an Egyptian princess or nonsense like that? Uncle Stevie never groomed us or did anything he shouldn't have." "He babysat us," Moon's voice was stubborn.
Of course he did. He was our uncle, helping Mum out.
And he took videos of us.
Look, what I'm saying.
Kirsten's breathing was ragged above me. The cramp had gone, but there was no way I could come out now. I hoped she wouldn't look down.
Listen, Moon, you've just taken a notion in your head. You've been listening to all these child abuse revelations and they're getting you confused. Of course, I remember him taking videos of us.
Her voice rose, then was clamped down.
Video was exciting back then. It wasn't like now when everyone's making films on their phone all the time.
We did a dance routine to Kylie Minogue and he filmed us. And then we watched ourselves. I remember that. I'd have been maybe 8, so you'd have been 6. I even remember us showing the video to Mum when she came home and us all laughing.
You make it sound like it only happened once. That's the time I remember. But you've blotted out the other times.
Kirsten snapped.
I haven't blotted out anything. There was nothing else. Nothing.
There was a long pause. I waited, hoping they'd move away. But there was no sound of footsteps on stone above me. At last, Moon said,
There was another girl, a neighbour. No, her father was your teacher, and his wife didn't go out much. But when she did, you used to babysit for her. Don't you remember?
Kirsten's voice was wary.
I remember babysitting from time to time. I was glad of the money. And one time I came along too because you'd already fixed up the babysitting. Then Mum had to go out and Uncle Stevie came and visited. He rang the doorbell while we were all watching telly and said he'd come along to make sure we were okay. The girl was in P1. With blonde curls, she was really sweet. There was a Peary brother too, but he was in bed, asleep.
Her name was...
It began with an S.
I don't remember anyone. According to you, it's all my imagination. Moon's voice sounded like she was pouting.
Maybe this girl will remember better. S, no, G, Gina, Ginny, Jane... Jenny, Jen, that was it.
Her voice was triumphant.
Jen, we danced with no clothes on. He shouldn't have got us doing that.
We didn't dance naked.
We did.
When we were peary, after we'd had a bath, we came down wrapped in our towels to have a cup of cocoa before bed. And this time, with that peary lass, Jen, you wouldn't do it, but she and I did.
Do you really not remember?
It didn't happen.
He encouraged us to dance like that and he videoed us.
Kirsten gave an angry laugh. You're just making this up.
You know I'm not.
Moon paused, then added defiantly, I went to visit a lawyer to tell him all about it. It wasn't right.
You did what? Oh, Moon, that was silly.
I didn't actually make a statement, though. I told the secretary what it was about, and then I wasn't sure if it really was something I remembered when you were so sure it wasn't, and I said I'd save it for another day and went out again.
Kirsten gave a long sigh of relief. Good. Now, listen to me, Moon.
Her voice coaxed. How about you forget all about it for this weekend, huh? We'll talk about it, really talk about it. Once we get home, we'll have an evening together, you and I, and talk about it. For now, though, how about remembering all the fun we had with Uncle Stevie when we were wee? Listen to his jokes. If he'd done something bad to us, he wouldn't joke with us all the time, would he?
Moon thought about that.
Suppose not, she agreed.
He wouldn't.
Kirsten's voice was firm. And like Mum said, it's his birthday. You don't want to spoil that for him. Remember the jellyfish fight? Moon began laughing. A voice from behind made us all jump. It was Stevie.
Having fun, girls? If it's a good joke, I want to hear it, or I'll have to tell you one of mine.
I heard his steps coming towards me. Isn't Cass about here somewhere? I thought she came this way. No? Come and pose again at the guns for me.
I waited until I was sure they'd gone before I moved cautiously in the other direction and eased myself upright behind this gun turret so they wouldn't see me if they looked back. I didn't feel ready to go out and be sociable yet. I leaned my back against the gun and looked out over the Rona, thinking. There was something not right about Moon. Too easily persuaded. I remembered that air she had of living in her own head. No doubt the Sorlana teachers would have a term for it. I'd been astonished these last weeks how laziness or stupidity or just plain awkwardness could all be diagnosed as something on a spectrum.
A lack of mother wit,
Magni would call it. Not necessarily a lack of intelligence, but a lack of the ability to read people and situations. A fool who jumped on a bandwagon and rushed blindly in where angels feared to tread. It was funny she'd come on this trip. No, maybe not. She seemed able to hold two things in her head at once. Her jokey Uncle Stevie and the dodgy man she said had filmed them naked as children. Not as two facets of the same personality as an adult would, but swinging from one to the other, not sure which was the real Stevie. Her mother had reminded her of the fun uncle whose birthdays she mustn't spoil, but being with Kirsten seemed to remind her of his more sinister side, if he had one. Moon herself didn't seem to be sure of it, and Kirsten said it was all therapy-induced nonsense. I'd have sided with Kirsten if there hadn't been something defensive in her denials, but I thought that if she kept saying nothing happened, Moon would probably believe her, unless, of course, some malign providence made her run into the other possible check on her memory, the Jen she'd mentioned. Jen. It wasn't a common name here. She'd be easy enough to trace if you knew her school year. You used to babysit her. Kirsten had been, say, mid-teens, and Jen had been P1, 7 or 8 years younger, in her early 40s. There'd be school yearbooks, or even a visit to Dennis Coutts in the street would do it. He'd have done the Bellsbury and signed primary school year photos back then. It would be easy enough to make up some excuse to get a print and then ask around, or back issues of the Shetland Times in the archives. We'd still done prize givings when I was at school, 10 years later, and they were listed in the papers, all our names with the commendations we'd achieved in various subjects. Jen's name would be there. It could all get very unpleasant. I just hoped we'd get the weekend over before a row blew up.
Chapter 3. We set off just after 11 and headed for the back of Papa Stour. It was a bonny day to be out, more summer than autumn, with the blue sky fretted with high cirrus and the hills smooth green. Only the colour of the water betrayed the season, a cold steely blue. The wake gurgled under Swan's forefoot and shushed along her sides. I brought up a tray of tea mugs and the biscuit tin as we chugged gently across the 6 miles of long Atlantic rollers towards the northern side of Papa. Our passengers were all up on deck, clustered comfortably around the main hatch. Stevie and Kirsten were leaning back against the grey rubber dinghy, legs stretched out on the warm deck, and Moon and Amatola sat upright on the step beside them, admiring the view and trying to work out where the West Borough Firth opening was. You'd never have thought, from Kirsten and Moon's faces, that they'd just quarrelled over whether their uncle had taken dodgy videos of them as children. Then I glanced aft and caught the expression on Stevie's face as he looked forward at Moon. He looked very far from being a loving uncle. Then, like the wind changing, The hard face was gone, and he was leaning towards Kirsten.
"Here's one for you, Kirsten. Did you hear about the mathematician who had a phobia about negative numbers? He'd stop at nothing to avoid them."
"Ouch," Kirsten protested. "Stevie, you missed your vocation. You should have been writing jokes for Christmas crackers." Amatola laughed. "How do you think he can afford his bike?"
"Okay," Stevie said. "Moon, here's one for you. Why do we tell actors to break a leg?"
Moon looked puzzled and shrugged.
"Because every play has a cast."
She thought about it for a moment. Then her face lit up and she laughed. I took myself out of earshot below. I was just heading to the wheel with tea when there was a throb of engines behind us. I looked over Magni's shoulder and saw the orange superstructure of the lifeboat between two plumes of foam.
"She is going back to the V-Skerries," Magni said. "A watching brief on the trawler as the tide comes in, and a try at getting her off with the coastguard tug. It was on the wireless while you were below."
Moon lifted her phone as Charles Lidbury passed by us and headed at speed towards the V-Skerries. I wasn't sure if we'd be able to see them at work on the trawler from the back of Papa. Not from on board, anyway. I started working it out. For someone standing at sea level, the horizon was 2.9 miles and the V-Skerries were 3 miles northwest of Papa. The Papa men had seen the men of the Ben Doran through spyglasses, but that had been from the cliffs on Papa. The Swan would give us at best an extra metre of height. Horizon distance equaled the square root of 1.144 times your height above the water in feet. It took me a moment to do the arithmetic, but I reckoned somewhere around 3.5 miles. Yes, we might be able to see what was going on. I'd just finished washing up the tea things and was back on deck when we reached Papa. Earth-brown cliffs fissured vertically, with long lines of white where generations of seabirds had nested. This side of the island was riddled with natural arches, continually being made and destroyed by the sea. Islet to arch, arch to stack, then the stack itself destroyed in a winter gale.
"Is that the V-Skerries?" Stevie asked at my shoulder.
He was pointing to a smudge on the horizon, low, grey shapes, like cloud on the surface of the water, and the upright of the Ormal light, glinting white as the sun caught it. I nodded and reached for the spyglasses. "You should be able to see what's going on with these." He snatched them from me and raised them to his eyes, fiddling with the wheel in the centre to get the best possible focus. As we came closer, I could see the orange of the lifeboat at the southern end of the Skerries and the white control tower and navy hull of the coastguard tug. There was a reef above water beside her, and I could just make out the trawler's white superstructure jutting above it. I glanced at the chart. It looked like she'd gone ashore on the southernmost Skerry, Da Club. She might be intact now, sitting on the rocks in this calm, but unless she could be floated off soon, she'd be battered into pieces by the next Atlantic gale. Stevie's knuckles were white on the glasses. If she couldn't be salvaged, she'd be an expensive loss for his firm. He watched until we came around Fogless Skerry and the V-Skerries were out of sight, and then handed the glasses back to me without a word said. We anchored in the bay behind Lyra Skerry, wallowing gently in the swell. It was a bonny lunch spot. A rectangular stack jutted out of the water. Beside it, on a Skerry white with gano, shag sat upright like penguins on an iceberg. Fowler lay to the southwest, 20 miles away, its three steps sharp against the sky, close enough now to see the contours within the outline, a cliff curving inwards from the right, and another, mistier, in the centre. Above it, the striped clouds glimmered pearl grey. We served up filled rolls for lunch, and Magni did a bit of yarning while we ate.
Right here, where we are now, Falk, was the scene of the 8th lifeboat's most dramatic and dangerous rescue, back in 1967. The Juniper, who went aground just below that cliff there. It's gone now, but there was a stack jutting up in front of the cliff, the Snalda. That means spindle. And the Juniper had steamed right up between the stack and the cliff. There were 12 men aboard. It was a cold February dawn when the lifeboat was called out. John Robert Nicholson, he was the coxswain of her then, and he brought her around Papa and around the outside of Fogla Skerry there. The coastguard chopper was in attendance, but the Juniper was too close to the cliffs for it to get the men off, so it was up to the lifeboat. Well, the tide was ebbing away, so that the trawler was sitting on the bottom, and there was barely enough water for the lifeboat to get in. The engineer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.